I'm Don O'Shea. I'm the president of New College. And welcome, everybody, please. So welcome both to those who know New College, and I see a lot of New College people here, and for those of you who don't, or whose first time it is here. If that's the case, please come back. It's an extraordinary institution, gorgeous institution, and it's quite lovely. They, I'd go to the Bayfront campus to start, and we'll show you around. As I said, New College is an extraordinary institution. It exists to prepare intellectually curious students for lives of great achievement. And so all those words matter. It's lives, not careers, not jobs. The intellectually curious, students thrive here who are intellectually curious. And great achievement, that's as defined by the student. Our students want to do very different things, and one of the things they come out of here with, hopefully, is the sense to understand and make their own decisions about what's most important to them in this world we live in. New College only has a little over 800 students. 80% go on to graduate or professional schools shortly after graduating. 16% of our graduates every year go on to earn PhDs in science and engineering. That's the National Science Foundation number. That's a preposterous percentage. It means one out of six. It's the third highest in the nation. Highest is Caltech, and it's ahead of fourth place MIT. And most of the students aren't science types as well, we produce a ton of lawyers. We produce a little more than 25%, closer to 30% of the state's Fulbrights. So the state university system has 300,000 students. So New College is producing more than a quarter of those that go on to earn Fulbrights, the nation's top honor. And I'm pleased to say 80% of our students volunteer in the community. So, and I love this audience, jeepers. you'll never get me down. But I do have to mention a couple of other things. One is we are on the move. The state's granted us money to grow by 50% to 1,200 students and 120 faculty. And now to the real thing, I'd like to thank our Black History Month committee. And there's too many to name, but the ringleader, who's not here, is Professor Mecca Zabriskie. And at least, but she has a genius for organizing everything else, and including a mob of students who've put on an incredible lot of programming that's just been fantastic. I'd also like to thank the Boxer Diversity Initiative, And Dan and Litton have really put together, now they have some advisors, but it's them, the program we're about to see tonight. It's just fantastic. And I'd also like to thank Booker High for the partnership with us. I do have to, I was collared by one of our faculty members, and I have to give a brief ad. The Florida Conference of Historians is meeting on campus this weekend. There are many wonderful events there. My favorite is probably I haven't seen any of them because it hasn't started yet, but the Equal Justice Initiative is giving a couple of talks. One of them is about a monument put up in outside of Montgomery to the African Americans who were murdered by white mobs, over 4,400 between 1875 and 1950. And how that got off the ground, the museum that went along with it, it's well worth seeing. And if you like history, there's just there's an incredible set of talks being given, many by New College professors and New College students, but many by historians across across Florida. That's in Sudikoff, which is a different hall that seats more, but it's on the New College campus. And now I would like to introduce or have come out Booker High's jet stream.
Stand by me. Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
My name is Dan Boxer, and Litton and I would very much welcome you and thank you so much for coming in almost virtually a full house to hear what I know and Litton knows will be an incredible program. And I want to thank the donors. I am not reading you out by name, but you are in the program. And you, these people and organizations have done so much to help us. Also, in the program, I hope you see the incredible work done by the Booker Law Academy. They are here tonight. Can you raise your hands? They're out there. There they are. Gail Foreman from Booker, who's one of the heads of the Booker Law Academy, really helped organize it. But it was the students themselves. So everything, all your complaints, don't go to me. Go to Booker. I also want to thank the speakers, because I know people, they're coming, these incredible people are coming tonight to talk to you, but actually, they have given up their time to come and talk to students both at Booker High School and at New College. And they are running seminars and programs. In many ways, it's important speaking to you and you learning, but it's important what they do with the students. So again, thank you, Dr. O'Shea, Donald, for hosting this thing, and to Mecca with what everything is done in New College. And I'm now going to introduce you to the moderator of the program, Chief Judge Charles Williams.
Thank you all. Let me just tell you a little bit about what the format's going to be. We're basically going to engage in a conversation with the three guests, three panelists I'm about to introduce. At a certain period of time, we're going to be able to entertain some questions. So if you have some questions, if you want to make your way to this stationary mic, we can do that. So without further ado, I'm going to ask the panelists to join me on stage. First, we have Dr. Michael Jeffries, Dr. Lady Hubbard, and Dr. Timothy McCarthy. So go ahead and have a seat. Okay, we all have handheld mics, so we've all been instructed to keep the mics up close to our chin. I want to let you know, I'm going to give the panelists their appropriate credentials, but there was a side agreement that they will refer to themselves by their first names. So if that happens, that has been by agreement. First of all, I'm going to introduce the person to my left, Dr. Timothy Patrick McCarthy. Dr. McCarthy is a lecturer on history and literature, public policy, education at Harvard University, where he is core faculty at the Carr Center for Human Rights Policy, an award-winning scholar, teacher, and activist. He is the author or editor of 5 books. He was also a founding member of Barack Obama's National LGBT Advisory Council and former board chair, vice chair for Free the Slaves, which hopefully you'll explain the title to that for me, please. To his immediate left is Dr. Lady Hubbard. Dr. Hubbard is the recipient of the 2016 Rona Jaffe Foundation's Writers Award for her first novel, The Talented Ripkins. She recently won the Zora Neale Hurston Richard Wright Foundation Legacy Award for Best New Fiction. She also was awarded the Ernest J. Gaines Award for Literary Excellence. Dr. Hubbard teaches at Tulane University in my favorite city after Sarasota, New Orleans. And back by popular demand,
yes.
Dr. Michael Jeffries. Dr. Jeffries is the Associate Professor of American Studies at Wellesley College. And we had Wellesley alumni here last time. He teaches courses on American popular culture and the politics of race and ethnicity. He is the author of numerous books, and his writing appears in both academic and popular outlets. Dr. Jeffries participated in our program last year, The Freedom Riders. He is back again by popular demand. So I'd like to set the tone by sort of giving an introductory statement to this event. We currently live in a country, and indeed a world today, where language and rhetoric has shaped and influenced how we elect our politicians, interpret the news, view visual media and the arts, among many other things. We hope tonight to be able to have an active dialogue to assist us in this process and unpackage and unbundle what we may feel internally and what we have observed externally as it relates to our feelings on language, on race, ethnic, gender, and sexual identity. Sometimes we say words without realizing the impact those words may have on others. The UC Davis LGBTQIA Resource Center posted on their website a list of commonly used words and phrases that are considered offensive. Included are words and phrases such as ghetto, acting ghetto, illegal alien, you guys. Including on their website were warnings about using the wrong pronouns or making others feel insecure in their gender identities. So this is the kickoff question for each panelist, and we'll start with Dr. McCarthy. What constitutes the language of racism and intolerance, aside from the obvious language?
Thank you, Judge. It's wonderful to be here, and thank you, both of you. It's wonderful and an honor to share the stage with you and all of you for coming tonight. It's wonderful to be in Sarasota. Let me, I can't believe I get the first question there. So, all right. I mean, embedded in the question is the idea that we have a general understanding of what those overt forms of racist language are and intolerant language are. And so the racial epithets and the anti-Semitic epithets and all of the language of intolerance and prejudice and violence that we hear. And there's that kind of language for every single group of people who are what I like to call on the downside of discrimination. And there are narratives, stories, master narratives in some cases that are developed, that are woven about those disenfranchised groups who are on the downside of discrimination where that language gets used. And then other words pop up, what in politics they call dog whistles. So when Ronald Reagan in 1980 announced his presidential campaign and he went to Philadelphia, Mississippi to do that and talked about states' rights in front of an all-white audience in Jackson, in Philadelphia, Mississippi, on the site where the three civil rights workers had been lynched and murdered, he was engaged in racist language, but it wasn't the racist language of the N-word or of anti-Semitic language, because one of the, I think two of the civil rights workers were also Jewish. But he was engaged in dog whistle politics because what he said when he said states' rights harkened back to a Southern strategy and to the language of the silent majority, which was also a kind of dog whistle language from the Nixon administration, that really was an anti-black civil rights language that white people in the audience understood. And so it was linked to a master narrative that had been linked to opposition to the civil rights movement that then made its way into the political discourse of the day. And we have all of these kinds of language now. But the one thing that I want to say is that I think it's important for us to unpack and to identify those dog whistle words and the more subtle, if you can call it that, language that we use to denigrate people. But I also think in this political moment, in this country right now, it's also important for us to call out and re-identify and amplify those words that are very explicit. I mean, I did a lecture down here in Sarasota last year on Trump's tweets. I took one for the nation on that one, folks. And I read his Twitter feed. I know, don't clap. Buy me a glass of wine. And there you see all of this subtle language, right? He's using all of these dog whistles. Build the wall itself is a dog whistle frame and phrase. And yet he's also sounding alarm bells with all of those other explicit words. And so I think it's really important for us not just to pay attention to the subtle stuff, but also call out the explicit stuff, and then to link them and to understand the narratives that they're embedded in our culture that help some people make sense of a changing world that is a threat to them, that they're afraid of.
Okay. Dr. Hubbard?
Oh, that's...
And Mike?
Can you hear me? No, that's really interesting. I was thinking about that in terms of dog whistles, because like I must be a different kind of dog, because it's very I feel like racism and racial discourse has gotten much more overt, right, than it was before Trump. And that's actually, as a writer, as a human being, something that's very interesting to me. So like I'm actually writing a collection of stories about the tea place between 1991 until the Obama election. And just because you said words, language of intolerance besides the overt, I was really thinking about how difficult it was to actually talk about race and discrimination, and actually, feminism even, during this period of time. And there was a lot of obfuscation. So, like, I was in California at the time, and when they abolished affirmative action at the universities, it was called the Civil Rights Initiative, right? And then you have, like, and this came out in Obama, right, for a reason, all the things about the war on drugs, right? So this is language that's actually very racist and racial, but doesn't address itself. You know what I mean? I don't know, so I feel like I get very conflicted about some of the things that are going on now, because I feel like there's a lot of repression in the, I don't know if that's the right word for it, but there's obviously a lot of hostility and unprocessed feelings about a lot of groups of people that's been there this whole time, and now it's like it can come out pretty freely, but it's not like Trump created it. It's just like now we can say what we really think, yep, or what we've been wanting to say for so long, but there was sort of maybe a stigma attached to it. So because I'm like, I live in Louisiana and stuff like that, so you have these images from the civil rights movement, so like, you know, children with, you know, getting attacked by dogs and stuff like that. And I really think people are like, well, there's certain things that because of that legacy, you have to be careful about how you express them and stuff like that, because they're aware of all of that. But it didn't actually go away. So just because you don't use the terms, or you find a very disingenuous way to express it, sometimes you can do a lot of real harm and damage. So I'm a little conflicted about what this particular cultural moment means, because I do feel like people need to, I don't want it to be there at all, but if it is there, it needs to be gotten out and processed and dealt with so that,
yes,
everybody can move forward, do you know?
Absolutely. Dr. Jeffries.
Yeah, it's an interesting time. The first place I wanted to go with the question was just remarking on how surprising this is to so many folks who study race and politics. There was a general consensus among political scientists who study things like campaigns and the rhetoric of race and racism that the country just wouldn't be receptive to explicit, obvious racial appeals anymore, that era was gone, and that if you were going to make these appeals, you had to make them kind of undercover in the way that Reagan did, in the way that Bush did with the Willie Horton campaign and things of that nature. But what the Trump presidency has shown is that either we've moved to a new time, or that consensus in political science was actually mistaken, because now you can use a combination of both. You can use a combination of the implicit and the explicit. And that's a dangerous thing, because there are real consequences to that sort of merging of implicit appeals and explicit appeals. Now the question becomes, I think you sort of raised it, Lady, what are we going to actually do about this? Right. Now, on one hand, as responsible citizens, we have a responsibility when it comes to political participation to reject it through voting and through the kind of discourse that we accept as legitimate political conversation. So we have to be able to say, you can't come and make an appeal to us as voters, or you can't have standing within our political party if this is the sort of language you think is in play. This language has no place in politics. That's one thing we have to do at the political level. I think it gets trickier when we talk about the everyday level. Because I think each of us would like to take the mantle and take some responsibility and believe that when faced with the opportunity to interrupt this language being used, we would stand up and call it out, right, and resist. But when we ask that of people, we have to be mindful of the power relationships that we're all living with. So if it's your first or second year in a new job and someone who you report to makes an off-color joke, the costs for you standing up to that person are wildly different than someone like a tenured professor standing up to one of his colleagues at a college or university. So I'm all for standing up and taking responsibility both in politics and in our everyday lives, but the onus has to be on those of us who have some level of security and who pay a slightly less expensive cost for taking those risks. It's not going to be distributed evenly because some people, it's dangerous in a bodily way, right? Not only could they be fired, they could be attacked, physically attacked for doing so. So I want us to be mindful of the privileges that come with that responsibility to interrupt. Okay.
And I did lose a bet. I said our president's name wouldn't come up for at least 20 minutes. I lost that bet. I'm going to direct the next question again to Dr. McCarthy, because I know that you have written and lectured on this issue. Locally here in Sarasota, our school system has dealt with the issues of gender identity in terms of designations of bathrooms for transgender students, and it's evolved into other issues, including gender identity basics, such as how does one refer to someone who now identifies outside of their birth gender. So the question that I have to you is how important is this issue, and why do gender pronouns matter? And does the failure to use these pronouns intentionally or unintentionally label someone as intolerant to the LGBTQIA community? Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. Thank you for that question. So I just this fall taught, so I was the first openly gay and LGBTQ faculty member at the Harvard Kennedy School in the history of the Kennedy School. And I was hired in 2006. Do that now. Clap and then weep. 2006. And 2018 in the fall, after 13 years of agitation, they finally allowed me to teach a course on LGBTQ policy, politics, and protest. First ever course ever at the Kennedy School in 2018. 13 years from when I was hired. Do the math. And so we got into this in the class because the class was, we had 30 some odd students in the class. It was a predominantly LGBTQ class, not entirely, really diverse mix of students in terms of nationality and race and ethnicity and gender identity and so forth. And so we got into this question. And some of the things that came out of that debate, I mean, first of all, let people go to the bathroom. Period. Like, let folks go to the bathroom. And if you're worried about their going to the bathroom in your bathroom, you step outside for a second and unpack why you're so concerned about them peeing. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that I think any language of identity is fundamentally about respect and disrespect. That you call people what they want to be called. You address people how they want to be addressed. I mean, you would do that if someone's name is Catherine, you're like, Cat, Katie, Catherine, right? Like, which would you prefer to be called? People ask me that all the time, Tim or Timothy, right? I mean, these are just given names, but there are also ways in which we identify ourselves. If someone wants to be called African-American, call them African-American. Don't call them anything else. If someone wants to be called queer, and you don't know what that means, call them queer. That's what they want to be called. Understanding, though, that language always exists in context. But I think it's really important as a matter of respect to do this. And for me, I talk to my students a lot about this in classroom settings because identity comes up and intersectional identity comes up and pronouns come up and all of these things come up in our classrooms these days, increasingly so, particularly around issues of gender identity and expression recently. And one of the things that I always say is to try to figure out where people's ignorance comes from. If you identify as they, them, theirs, and someone refers to you as a she or a he, and they don't know the differences between those things and the, what those different pronouns mean, and they've never had a conversation with you about how you prefer to be referred to, then that kind of ignorance that you experience, right, is an unwitting kind of ignorance that I think requires intervention and it requires education, it requires evolution. If someone knows that you want to be called they and you call them he or she, then you have done something willful in terms of your ignorance, and therefore you should have another kind of intervention, right? You should be told that that can't happen again. And I think that this is one of those moments where I think teachers and allies and bystanders who can be upstanders and other folks can help with those interventions so that the burden doesn't fall on the people who are already on the downside of discrimination and misrepresentation and caricature and so forth. So for me, the current kind of difficulty and debate and challenge around gender pronouns is something that's not going away. So let's start to, if you're not wrapping your head around it, let's get to that place, because this isn't going anywhere. It's only going to become more complicated. And I do think that there needs to be a sort of space for people to evolve, because this is one of those places where I think the way the language around gender identity right now as a kind of broader cultural phenomenon that people are sort of keen to understand, or they know they should understand it, or it's creating problems for them in some way, I think is at a fever pitch, right? And it plays out in these policy debates about bathrooms, and it plays out in classrooms, and it plays out in relationships and other kinds of things. And so I think we need, as a society, to engage more fully, to open our minds more broadly, and to not bury our heads in the sand, or even worse, be the kind of willfully ignorant folks who are really trying to misgender or misrepresent or just really denigrate or dehumanize another human being who has asked to be respected with that language.
And speaking of language and pronouns, from a writer's perspective, I would like Dr. Hubbard, if you want to say anything about that.
About pronouns?
Pronouns, the importance of using a pronoun, the gender identity, and how important, or is it something that enters into your thoughts process when you are developing characters for your fiction novels?
You mean in terms of their gender identity?
Yes. Mm-hmm. And if you'd hold the mic up a little bit.
Yeah.
So, yeah, but I mean, it's true. It's when you were talking about this, I was thinking, because they're so, I actually feel somewhat ignorant, like, about a lot of things. And then I was thinking there are all these parallels with race. Like, sometimes people don't know, and I'll be like, why don't you know? Do you know? And I'm sure, like, a lot of people would say that to me about a lot of things. So I don't want to be, I don't want to be ignorant. But honestly, when you were talking, because everything you were saying about respect and just if someone wants to be called something, of course that's what they should be called. But I actually feel like I have a lot to learn about all of that. So, yeah, so it was really making me think in terms of parallels with that. And I don't write, this is a related question, because there's a big issue, a lot of issues going on right now in terms of people writing outside of their own sort of cultural identity. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of anxiety about doing that. And so I would say that I write based on my own experience in terms of that. So that I have had like gay and lesbian characters, but they're all like of my generation, and it's sort of, it is much more based on my own experience. And honestly, this is very interesting to me because of my response when I'm asked about people writing, because in a way, when you are always imagining yourself as someone else when you're writing a fictional character, so it always is sort of a leap of faith. I have my own consciousness and understanding of the world, and I'm projecting that onto all kinds of people. But I actually, I don't even know where I would begin, like to write something I totally didn't understand. I'm being honest,
which is what we want you to do.
Yeah, so I have, but I feel really like I need to learn more, do you know?
Yeah. Dr. Jeffers, anything you want to add to that?
I mean, I would just add one thing almost on the tail end of what you said, Tim, is that we're starting to see some real institutional changes around these issues, not only with bathrooms, but also things like birth certificates, high school curricula, Yeah. So we're starting to see some real changes at the institutional level, and that's absolutely vital because there has to be a real model of restitution and reform. Restitution for the harm that's being done when harm is done, and reform for those who want to do better but don't have the tools, don't have the practice, don't have the education, or living just ignorant of these preferences and of the harm that they're doing. So on one hand, you know, you want to say, when you're having a one-to-one interaction with someone, be respectful of that person. But we also need to think about what are the rules that we have in our organizations, in our workplaces, at our schools, that give us all the tools we need to cultivate that respect on a mass level, so that it's not up to me as an individual educator or you as a writer to educate yourself before you go into the classroom and teach a writing class, or I teach a class on politics, but that just like I would have an orientation for where the cafeteria is and what do I do about my retirement package at work, I'm having an orientation for precisely these sorts of issues. And the way I think about it is, as an educator, you never really know what's going to make the difference in a student's life. You just don't know. And it probably won't be that thing that you put on your syllabus at the last moment, that brilliant comment you made in a lecture. It'll be some fundamentally human thing that you did and maybe forgot about that made that student believe in themselves. And you don't know what that is. So when you make these concessions, when you put yourself in an uncomfortable place, when you apologize to the student, if you make a mistake when it comes to misgendering someone, that can be the difference between a student who stays in your class and leaves. That can be the difference between a student who chooses to stay as a psych major or who chooses another major. These are huge shifts in the lives of young people. And I don't think we truly understand and respect some of the hidden costs that we force young people to pay by things that, when we could have prevented them from paying it with the simplest concession, what seemed like the simplest and most unspoken concessions.
Can I just add one quick anecdote put a punctuation or an exclamation point on that? And you know, all of us who teach have these moments, right? Whether we know they've been had or not, yeah. We find out about them later on. But I had a moment in class 2 years ago in another class where I gave an anecdote about someone who had stepped up at a microphone at an event like this and done something that I thought was particularly compelling in terms of leadership and communication. And I was teaching that in this class. And I knew that the person who had spoken at that microphone was someone who used they as their pronoun, as wanted to be referred in that way. And I told the story using they, them, theirs in the class. And the student came up to me afterwards and said, I've never had a teacher in my entire life, 2 master's degrees all the way through high school, and I grew up in California, ever use non-gendered, non-he, she pronouns telling a story. And I just want to thank you. And then fast forward to the summer, I was advertising the CA, the course assistant role for my new course on Queer Nation. And this student applied to that. And it turns out this student was transitioning last year when they were in my class. And I did not know that. And this student, they are the first transgender student out in the history of the Kenny School and was my CA for this class this fall. So that is exactly that kind of thing. And I want to say, I misgender too. Like, I slip up. We're on a learning curve on this, right? I'm a cisgender person. I'm not a transgender person. So, you know, we're on a learning curve, and this language is we're learning it. Right?
Is there an official policy in terms of like why wouldn't you respect someone's choice about how they identify?
You should.
Yeah.
Policies, I mean, prejudice. I think.
Right. Yeah, no, yeah, I mean, right, in terms of like the school. Like, I don't know why would some, but does that probably happen?
Oh, it happens
like,
all the time. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, we're gonna break a little bit, and I don't want to say I'm playing the devil's advocate, but certainly there are people that are concerned, just like. Dr. Hubbard, as you said, not knowing. And so I want to talk about incidents where people have certain views, have certain ideas, and yet they're sort of afraid to really express those views and ideas for fear of offending. And so let me just preface it by saying, are we being too intolerant of those whose views and statements may clash with our own? And when does one cross the line and their honest expressed opinions about race, gender, religion, sexuality become racist, sexist, or insulting to a person or a defined group. So what are the rules of engagement, I guess, would be the question, and any of the panelists can answer that.
That's a great question, and it's a very tricky one. I mean, I think the place my mind goes first and foremost is to power. If you have someone in a position of power who is claiming a position of victimhood erroneously, right, and saying, you can't make me use a certain kind of language, you can't victimize me, I'm just gonna speak my mind, that's a kind of disingenuous call for freedom of expression, right? But if you can create circumstances where there are mediators, there are people who are trained to have intercultural dialogue, this is actually a skill set that, again, is not part of necessarily our training as academics or necessarily as teachers. There's a whole kind of field on this, right? How do you have intercultural dialogue? If you can cultivate those spaces, those are the best spaces for it to happen. When you have a platform where people can share equally, and ideally someone in the middle who can negotiate those conversations. But when you have situations where the power is really unequal, that I think is where real harm gets done.
Yeah. Over to Dr. McCarthy.
We're all taking turns. Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm really thinking about this more as a writer than in like class.
And that's why you're on the panel. And the mic closer to your chin. There's a guy in the sound booth waving, so I need to...
Well, because there are parallels. There are always parallels. So in terms of power, right? So in publishing, right? And expectations in terms of publishing, and those are sort of like inherent power relations, what gets published and what doesn't, what is considered like sort of... not mainstream voice and stuff like that. So that's a different way and a different means of talking about it. So I don't know. That's a huge issue for me. You guys are all talking about this in like a very academic way, and that's not really how I think. So everything is getting processed in my mind in a slightly different way, to be perfectly honest. Because there are very real consequences of that. Certain voices do find much louder expression than others. Right, which is the context for that. And that's like a very tangible circumstances for talking about that. But anyway.
So. Yeah. Dr. McCarthy, anything you want to add?
I mean, you know, you go to power when you talked about going to power, and I always go to respect, which is also about power. Right? I mean, disrespect is an abuse of power, usually, and involves some differential in terms of power relations. Not always, but it often is, certainly when you're talking about racism or misogyny or homophobia or transphobia, you're talking about abuses of power, social power and institutional power in some ways. One thing I would say, though, two things. One is I agree with you that the burden is the responsibility and the burden of acting or speaking up is greater for people who have more power, right? The tenured professor over the graduate student in that instance. But I also don't think we can wait for that, right? I think that one of the things that I see all the time in academia, right, is all of these graduate students who are told not to make a peep or do anything out of step so that they can do the trajectory and they know exactly what to do that. And I was someone who quickly violated those rules and rebelled against them, and that's one of the reasons I've had the weird career that I've had. And so be it. Fine. But I don't think you can wait to that, because I think if you wait all through graduate school and then all through your tenure track, that's like a decade and a half, right? And like, what are you losing in terms of bravery and moral leadership and power if you're waiting to get tenure to be the Bayard Rustin or Audre Lorde or whatever? And I think that history is full of people who had no power, who were the most brave speakers of truth to power. And so I think we have to, yes, hold the people with a lot of power accountable for being the kind of folks who speak out when they see injustice, but like, we can't wait for that, because the people, very rarely is, when you speak truth to power, are they the CEO and the university president speaking truth to power to each other, right? It's people from below. It's the workers who are screwed in the company that the CEO runs, and the students who are alienated in the universities that the president runs. And so we can't wait for that, even though I agree with your sense of a particular burden or responsibility. The second thing is that I think it's absolutely vital that we live in and we build communities that are diverse in every way, including ideologically. Like, I do worry that we are, for some good reasons and some very, very bad reasons, building our own kinds of walls from one another, right, to keep us kind of safe. And what I want people to be safe. I do. I want people to be safe and secure. I don't want anyone to be a victim of violence or discrimination or any of those things. But I also want people to be brave. And I want people to learn how to respect each other. And I want people to learn how to be in solidarity with each other and develop empathy for one another and ultimately develop love for one another. And we can't do that if we're building ideological walls along with all of the other barriers and boundaries that we build and police every day.
Can I ask you,
yeah,
if I'm curious?
Sure.
When you say ladies, building ideological walls, what do you mean by that?
I mean building ideological walls where the only people we ever talk to are people who think exactly the way we do. Right. And yes. I think that there's a danger of that. I do see that happening on campus and times and among intellectuals and among political partisans of various. That's what I mean.
Do you feel like that's new?
No, I think it's more heightened, and I do think there's more of a polarization. One of the things that's actually happened, there's data out right now. The Pew Foundation did this political polling data during the 2016 election, which found that we were as polarized politically in terms of party affiliation and liberal, conservative, all that, as we had been in since the 60s. And that the difference was not just the polarization, but that the feelings that people had towards the opponents or the people who are on the other side of an issue were feelings of disgust and fear, not opposition and disagreement. And that people were much more likely to report that a conservative disgusted, a Republican disgusted them, or Hillary Clinton disgusted them, or Donald Trump disgusted them than ever before.
Why do you think that is, though? No, seriously. I mean, I know it sounds, it's terrible, but honestly, why do you think that is? Because it is, to say it's a polar, that's there's two sides of that. It's a very polarized time right now.
Yeah, I think that's part of it, and I think a lot of the behavior is disgusting. I mean, frankly, I think a lot, I also feel disgust when I read Donald Trump's Twitter feed, right? I mean, I think he's the worst devil of the nation. And if he were to walk in right now, would I want to sit down and have a conversation with him about immigration policy? No, I'd probably want to punch him in his face, right?
Okay.
Walk out.
Okay, I've lost my second bet. My second bet. All right. On that same track, and I know that Dr. Jeffries is going to circle back to this because we discussed it once before. And that is, we talk about intolerance, but we also, sometimes the critics say there's intolerance of diverse thought. And so the question I'm proposing is by censoring or telling someone their language or their writings or their speeches are contrary to what we feel is appropriate, are we causing more harm by stifling honesty and free expression? And I just want to talk about what's probably not been a recent phenomenon, but a phenomena of banned or interrupted commencement speakers at colleges. So since we're at a college, I thought a few examples. At Williams College, John Derbyshire, the writer and journalist, was due to speak at Williams, but the college president canceled the event, citing writings that some considered to be racist. At Cal State University at Los Angeles, Ben Shapiro, critics slammed a conservative writer and claimed that his proposed lecture about microaggressions, Black Lives Matter, and safe places was not a debate but an attack. At Virginia Tech, Jason Riley, a professor who invited the Wall Street Journal columnist, his invitation was revoked over concerns of a controversy because he had, quote, written about race issues. So all of you have lectured on college campuses where that may be an issue. So is it fair, really, to have students be able to dictate who comes to their campus? And isn't the purpose of colleges to encourage debate and to encourage people who may have different views to express them.
Right.
I'm going to start with Dr. Jeffries because we've talked about this.
Right. Yeah, we have. I mean, this is a real. This is another really tricky one. I think it's one that colleges across the country are dealing with in different ways. To answer you directly, no. Like, students don't have the power to set the agenda, to vet every speaker that comes. If what you're truly interested in doing, though, is having an open and honest debate, inviting a hate monger on stage to talk down to an audience is not a way to cultivate that debate. It's not. That's a way to shut down debate. So if you feel as though you must have a person with an objectionable opinion on campus to expose your students to a variety of ideas, it might be a good idea to have a foil up there on stage with that person to present the other side of the opinion so that both sides are truly being heard and the power relations are equal. They each have a microphone, they each have standing, and they're each kind of providing some sort of education for the audience. So that's one way that we can solve so many of these issues, I think. But I also want to be careful because the kinds of speakers we invite to campuses and fora like this also really matter. So the expectations when it comes to the idea of free speech are very different when we're talking about an artist from what they might be when we're talking about an academic or a scientist. A scientist does not have license to just play with the rules, to make up things that are untrue, to falsify scientific data. That's a violation of the vocation. Right? It's a fireable offense, literally. An artist, on the other hand, is licensed to do precisely that, right? To play on the margins of our imagination, political and otherwise, and to force us into uncomfortable places. That ultimately is why we remember so much of the greatest art, not because it appealed to our aesthetic sensibilities, but because it made us feel uncomfortable. Right? So we need to be careful not to collapse these different categories of speakers and educators into the same group. An artist is not the same as an opinion columnist for the Wall Street Journal, is not the same as a scientist, is not the same as a novelist. These are different kinds of speakers that have different rules and expectations for what the standard is. And if you can find a speaker, right, that has a certain reputation, a certain demonstrated commitment to integrity and consistency of argument, no matter what field they fall in, that's a good person to have. Just don't let them abuse that power. Don't put them up there on a podium where they are then sort of talking down to students who then feel compelled to speak up in a way that they're really not necessarily prepared for and shouldn't have to all the time. And then whether they want to or not is ultimately up to them, right? We shouldn't discourage them from doing so, but it's best, I think, to have a variety of ways to have open debate rather than just letting it sort of spin out of control in the ways we've seen so far.
Okay. Anyone else?
I would have protested all of those commencement speakers you just mentioned, to be perfectly honest. I probably would have. And I feel like, just being honest, I feel like I hear certain opinions and certain ideas expressed all the time. And so that doesn't really represent like a different opinion to me. Do you know what I'm saying? So that the sometimes things that are highly offensive in terms of being exposed to new ideas, I've already heard that, or I've already lived that. I know that already. So that doesn't, for me, that's not really being exposed to a new idea.
But the question again, though, is are we preparing, whether it's college students or high school students, if we insulate them from different thoughts, even racist or sexist thoughts?
How are they insulated?
In terms of banning the speakers, in terms of saying that you can't listen to them, in terms of saying you shouldn't read their materials or listen to their rhetoric. You may not believe their rhetoric, but isn't it part of the educational process to know that it's there and then learn how to adjust to it or react to it?
My son was just having this argument with me about, I can't remember, it was Tom Sawyer or Huckleberry Finn or something like that. There are so many opinions and so many things to hear and be exposed to that, like, a lot of people are never exposed to. Like, if you really wanna like value divergent thought and divergent ideas, the things you're describing, those are not really new or different ideas so far as I can hear. There's all kinds of things that if that's really what you wanna do, mm-hmm. that people, you could spend the time and the energy to expose them to. Just because something is like tradition, this is the tradition, the traditional parameters of discourse, doesn't mean that you have to validate it. There are all kinds of opinions about absolutely everything. If you want to really expose people to divergent ideas, you don't have to like constantly look to the same sources. Because again, for me, that's not really new. Though that doesn't represent new or different thought.
Dr. McCarthy.
Yeah, I mean, I would say a couple things. One is commencement speeches, right, are a particular kind of speech, right? That's a celebrated, elevated honor for whoever gets invited to come give that speech. And so that comes with a certain kind of cultural power that some people just don't deserve, right? And want, but don't deserve. And so I think that's a different kind of thing than whether campuses should whether student groups and different faculty members and centers and institutes should be able to invite a whole slew of folks from all over the place. And I absolutely agree with that, that we should have lots of different kinds of folks, and people can choose which events to go to, and they can protest some, they can go and clap at others, they can do all of that. I was one of those people who protested a commencement speaker. Colin Powell was my commencement speaker when I graduated from Harvard in 93, and he announced the Don't Ask, Don't Tell policy at my commencement. And so a whole bunch of us wore pink triangles on our mortar boards and lift the band buttons, and my parents were upset that I had them in all the pictures at commencement, but there they are. I was out before I was out. But the thing that was interesting is we weren't protesting Colin Powell the person. Right, that morning, I was a class officer. I had a debate with him about the Don't Ask, Don't Tell policy that morning at my commencement before he gave his speech. And it was me and the president of the Campus Republican Club, and Susan Sontag and Colin Powell. They're both getting honorary degrees. And we had this big debate about gays in the military that morning, right? And I, when he spoke, I stood up, I turned my back, we had a protest, and it was a whole thing. And he spoke, and he also got the message. He evolved, right? He's now in where we are and where we were. And so there's a moment, and he has talked about the fact that he was protested at that commencement and how it shifted and opened him up to some kind of questioning of this policy that he had to support because he was the head of the Joint Chiefs at the time, right? More recently, Charles Murray was invited. And one thing that's happening on college campuses, particularly college campuses that are perceived to be more liberal-leaning, and Wellesley, I'm sure, and Harvard and Tulane, these are all places like that, the new college. And one of the things that's happening is that that there are on campus elements more conservative than liberal, at least in Harvard's case, that are trying to invite the most extreme, provocative, fake news, pandering folks. And so Charles Murray was invited to campus last year. And what our students did, instead of shutting down him and getting him disinvited, they decided they were going to hold a counter panel where there were a bunch of scholars at Harvard who were actually credentialed to talk about race and science and all of these things, that they were in a panel in the same building at half an hour later. So people went and protested Charles Murray. Some people stayed and dominated the Q&A session, right? And then the rest of us went to the counter panel. And we had an amazing kind of teach-in about race and science and history and progressive politics and the value of protest, and it was amazing. And these two things happened almost simultaneously, and it was a win, I think. I would think it was a big win in many ways. And the students organized the whole thing. And they got some smack for it from Fox News and all the usual suspects. But at the end of the day, what they did was they organized an intellectual and political and moral response to a hack, who I didn't even realize was still alive at the time. I thought, I mean, I was protesting Charles Murray when he published The Bell Curve. I was like, that cat's still here? My God. Okay.
Yeah. And that's right, Dr. Jeffries.
I mean, that's such a great example. Yeah. That's such a great example because it really does model the kind of dialogue that, to be frank, we have this kind of dialogue in our courses already. So in some ways, this is an invented controversy. I don't know one person who teaches about racism who doesn't actually teach what racist ideologies are. Like, you can't actually do the teaching if you don't expose the students to the ideas and understand where they come from. So I think in many ways this is an invented controversy, specifically when it comes to the college setting. Now, Murray is an interesting case. This is really just a footnote, but this is one of the more peculiar ones because his work was debunked a long time ago. And that's a case where, while usually I'm all for, right, inviting people with divergent viewpoints, that's where, as a social scientist, he really no longer has standing. So at Columbia University, for example, they had an open letter to a whole bunch of people. The law school signed onto it. People from the sociology and the history department signed onto it, explaining why Murray was no longer considered a legitimate a commentator on this issue. And I think that's one of those areas where we need to be very careful in why it is that we're not allowing this person here, because he's violated some sort of professional standard here that we can't have, right? If you're going to throw that into crisis in a college or university, you won't have a place of learning for much longer.
In a few moments, we're going to actually ask the audience either to have submitted questions by index cards or if they want to come to the mic. But when I was trying to put together a flow chart of how I wanted the conversation to end, I said, I think it's important that we talk about something topical that's happening in terms of racism and intolerance. Every day there was a new issue, right? So I would email Dan Boxer with, hey, we should talk about this. Well, wait a minute, let's talk about this. So every day there was a new, but I had to come back home to Virginia, right? And so we are, of course, familiar with the recent events in the state of Virginia, specifically dealing with the governor of that state, Ralph Northam, and the photograph of him taken in 1984, either in blackface or a Klansman's costume. We're not sure, and he's not sure, which of the two characters were him. But I thought it was important for the panelists to give their views and share with our audience the obvious question, which is probably the biggest softball question I'll ask, is why is this so offensive to the level there are calls for his resignation, even though the event occurred over 30 years ago? So, go ahead.
I think this is really...
Mike? I prepped them.
Wouldn't it have been like, because it seems like everybody at that school put on blackface?
Yes.
Everyone
this
there.
This is the Eastern Virginia College of Medicine, which has a yearbook, which is kind of weird in and of itself, but go ahead.
Yeah, he was a grown man when he did that, and it really was not that long ago, so it's kind of like too recent, I think, to not know better. But at the same time, I think it would have been a very different thing if he had told people he did this, as opposed to being caught having done something. Like, if he'd come out and said, I did this, it was a mistake, I learned from it, and, you know, I'm a totally different person now, I really think people would respond to it in a different way, as opposed to someone, you know, digging it up from your past. Okay. Because, yes, I do think people make mistakes, and they should be allowed to grow and evolve. But I do think there's something about not owning up to mistakes that you've made.
And a follow-up question, and then the Dr. Jeffries or Dr. McCarthy, at what age can such acts be forgiven? Locally, statewide in Florida, there was another blackface incident with a Florida politician, but this happened in high school. And somehow, this person has survived the storm. Another politician in Florida, also in blackface, didn't survive the storm because this happened after, I believe, he left college. So can any of these acts be forgiven? Is there a statute of limitations? What if the person has denounced or renounced their stupidity and their bigotry? Just your general thoughts on that. I'll ask Dr. Jeffries, and then I'll ask Dr. McCarthy to weigh in.
I hesitate to wade into a conversation about statutes of limitation with a judge. So...
But you're not being graded. I won't grade you.
Okay. To answer very simply, yes, these things can be forgiven. I think some of the things you said are very instructive and very wise about what's required in terms of acknowledging one's culpability and demonstrating, not only saying I've grown from this, but demonstrating some degree of growth for this. What's interesting to me, though, is, you know, in the case of Northam, among the many disturbing features of this real tragedy are, one, he's in a position of political power and doesn't seem to understand the level of dehumanization and the level of dehumanization that is tied fundamentally to politics. These are not just cultural performances that have no bearing on the distribution of rights and resources. This is part and parcel of a campaign of terrorism against black people in the United States. It's a terrorist act designed to denigrate and instill fear in people. That's what this is, and he has never, in all of his statements and foibles since then, really demonstrated that he understands the severity of what is going on in that picture. And at the news conference, his wife actually had to check him and tell, he was trying to joke about it. This is not a joke. This is not a joke. This level of dehumanization and terror is not a joke, right? So in his case, that's one of the things that's so difficult about it. Secondly, the man is a doctor. We know by now how deep the channels of discrimination and prejudice are in the medical profession against black people, and in particular for black women, right? We look at the mortality rates from childbirth, for example, as the most often cited story that illustrates these issues, right? So this is someone who's took the oath and is supposed to be caring for people. How can we have any faith that he's not violating that oath, right? That he swears when he becomes a doctor. So that's another sort of major issue that we have. Then, I still don't think we really understand the level of the flaunting of power and pleasure that is involved when white people perform in blackface. It is not just about applying the makeup. It is about the fact that white folks who do this can take the makeup off. The joke is not, right? The joke and the humor and the pleasure that they get from it is not that black folk are dark. That's not what makes them so giddy to do it. Is that they are white. Blackface is a celebration of whiteness and white supremacy. Fundamentally, that's what it is. And I don't think we've really understood as a country, beyond the history of blackface as a performance tool and a costume, what the significance of that act is. The power to remove the stain, that is the pleasure in it. Regardless of whether it's Michael Jackson or pimps and hoes parties at college or any of these other offensive characters that are created in these circumstances, I don't think we really understand the psychology of white supremacy that's embedded in the performance. We haven't had this, we want to hold Northam accountable, and we should, but we still haven't had a conversation about how white supremacy is operating in this case. Yeah. Yeah?
Okay, Dr. McCarthy, and if there's anything you want to add to that, go ahead, Dr. Hubbard. But we'll go with Dr. McCarthy first, and then Dr. Hubbard.
All of that. And, I mean, somewhere in Virginia, there is an attending surgeon who was under that hood.
Yes.
There are people going to the doctor's office to the guy who, if it wasn't Northam, it was his medical school colleague. And so, I'm like, who's under the hood? And Northam doesn't know. First he's, oh yeah, and then he's like, oh no, maybe. You know, I mean, Virginia's a mess. And they got a yearbook problem. But Virginia's been a mess since 1619. This year is the 400th anniversary. I don't need to tell everybody this, but some people maybe don't know this history. 400 years ago this year, in 1619, the first boatload of folks who were stolen from Africa against their will and brought to North America, mainland North America, arrived in the Jamestown colony. 160 some odd years before the Declaration of Independence, before the slaveholding Thomas Jefferson wrote, all men are created equal, before the Constitutional Convention 11 years later, which made all sorts of compromises about slavery, couldn't actually name the damn thing. couldn't even use the language of race. Talk about a dog whistle. The Constitution is filled with dog whistles. And the Constitution is filled with dog whistles, and the Declaration of Independence has a whole final grievance that Thomas Jefferson wrote, blaming slavery in the United States at a time when he owned 156 slaves that he inherited from his father, couldn't free because he was in debt. He wanted to blame the King of England for slavery in the colonies. And Thomas Jefferson sent the draft of the Declaration of Independence to John Adams and Ben Franklin and other members of the drafting committee, like, oh, no, 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 no. We can't have this here. They're going to call us hypocrites. So they edited out that whole final grievance, which we don't know. We never teach that in schools. I start my protest literature class teaching the draft of the Declaration, and my students are like, oh, whoa, right? So Virginia's been a mess for a long time before Northam came into power. And I think that this is, on some level, it's about all the stuff that you've said, but it's also about politics, right? We have to put this into a long political tradition that dates back to the founding of Virginia as a slave colony, as the slave colony in the colonies that become the United States of America. And you have to put this into a recent political context, right, where you have someone who is poised to be the governor if Northam resigns, who would be the second black governor in the history of the Commonwealth, who's now dealing with his own controversies with sexual assault allegations. And Northam would be gone if it weren't for that complication, right? And we would have a black governor of Virginia, right? And then we have to take into account the fact that Northam can only be redeemed if he has done the political and moral work to earn the redemption. And if he can't even figure out if he was one of those people in the thing and that he didn't have a yearbook but took a picture for a yearbook and had all this, so he can't even do that, he has definitely not done the work to cleanse himself of the legacies of white supremacy to earn the right to be the representative of the people of Virginia. And then I think there's the anxiety right now in Virginia, right? There's anxiety that all these folks have problems. Some have yearbook problems, some have white supremacy problems, some have blackface problems, some have hood problems, and some have sexual assault problems. And if you trickle down through all of those problems, you get a right-wing person who's like seventh in charge who's going to be the governor. And the Democrats in Virginia don't want to go back because they've spent the last 15 years trying to turn that state from red to blue, kind of purple sometimes, and they don't want to lose that. So there's that political thing. And then there's the complication of the latest poll that says that more black people want Northam to stay in office than white people in Virginia. And I'm like, this place is a hot, steaming mess. But it's been a mess since 1619. Okay.
Okay, we're gonna have Dr. Hubbard respond, but I'm gonna ask Dan to get in position to read any questions. And if you have any questions, if you can make your way somehow to this mic, we'll try to get some. But Dr. Hubbard.
No, that's fine.
No one wanted to follow Dr. McCarthy.
Oh my gosh.
Okay, so we're. That was a drop the mic moment for Dr. McCarthy.
I'm kind of going back to the very beginning of your first few questions. See, I really was listening in the beginning. It has to do with literally the language itself. So there's kind of two parts here. I've heard that saying I'm not racist implies that I'm racist. So the question that goes with that is there any way at all to have a discussion about racism without being labeled as being racist?
So any of the panelists want to answer that question?
No.
No? All right, Dr. Jeffries is gonna attempt to answer that question.
Yeah, that's we can share up here. I think we're good. You can keep that one in the audience. It's fine. Yeah. I mean, I think that's a good question. It's an honest question, an earnest question. I think it's one that we've probably heard from our friends and from students for sure. First of all, I think we are constantly figuring out how to have conversations about racism, despite the discomfort and the trepidation about saying something wrong or saying something that might be perceived as racist. The You know, if your question is, what do I do about someone who says I'm not racist? I mean, I think what that really requires, and it's sort of boring and academic, but it really requires us to have some sort of common ground about what it means, what racism actually means, right? Some people say it's just prejudice. Some people say it's bias, which is can be prejudice, can be explicit prejudice, can be implicit. Some people say it's discrimination. Some people say it's prejudice plus power. But figuring out a way to figure out what do we actually mean when we say the word racist? The way I teach it is, right, you can't possibly understand what racism is if you're going to reduce it to an individual act or a set of motivations or ideas. Right? Racism is embedded in our institutions. Racism is also psychological, but that's probably not necessarily where it comes from, where it springs from, right? When you have laws, when you have a Declaration of Independence or a Constitution, right, written in such a way to separate, to discriminate, to violate the rights of a certain group of people, right? That's where a lot of this stuff comes from. So the individualization of racism, I think, is something that we need to address when it comes up, but move toward a more sort of collective and institutional conversation about it. I don't think that all of these conversations about racism are just being shut down all the time. I just think that we're struggling with them. Sometimes we're doing better, and sometimes we're doing worse.
To say I am not a racist is a very interesting place to be beginning with in trying to have a conversation about race and racism. So I just wanted to point that out. Like, to begin a conversation about misogyny with I am not a sexist, or homophobia with I am not homophobic, because you're already really narrowly, maybe you just don't understand, right? It kind of is an expression of not being open to things that you haven't. It's a bit closed if you think about it, right? Maybe you're not intentionally racist. I just wanted to point that out. That's actually it's a very interesting statement to begin a conversation about race and racism with.
Okay. If you want to briefly respond, and then we're going to take some questions.
Yeah, just to build on that, I actually think that prefacing a conversation on race and racism with "I'm not a racist" or "I don't see color" or any permutation of those things is not the entrance point. And one of the things that I feel is vitally important as someone who happened to be born with white skin in this country, I think, if we are ever to have any hope of moving forward, white people have to move through that anxiety and fear about being called a racist, which is like the number one fear among white people, particularly among white liberals and white progressives. There are some white folks who don't mind being called a racist because they own that. And that's fine, but the anxiety and fear along the kind of, you know, moderate to liberal to progressive spectrum of white people, and I hear it all the time. I have some white friends, and they... And they are often expressing that anxiety to me before they meet my black husband or my black family members or other black friends. And so they're trying to figure out how to do this. And that's the central anxiety. And white people have to get through that. We have no hope to live in a racially just and equitable world if white people are either self-silencing or stumbling into a conversation about race and racism with that preface.
Okay. All right. And if you want to come to the mic, please, what's your question? And the question would be directed to any panelist.
Yeah. Oh, whoa. Okay. It's a good mic. It's closer? Like that? Okay. So my question was, and anyone can answer, as all of you, I think, have some basis in this. So my question was, how can young people get involved in the conversation or change false narratives?
Okay.
That's my question.
Anybody want to?
You can write a novel. You could write a
okay.
You could, there you go. Right? And that's actually very important. We talk about that a
yes.
lot. Talk okay. about that like there's a, in terms of realism, right? As a construct, I think it's very important, but again, I'm a writer.
So. All right, next question.
Good evening. I'm a teacher at Booker High School, so my question is in context of that. I have a question about how do I remain politically unbiased in my classroom and encourage respectful and inclusive discourse among my students when it feels like today we live in a society where human rights are considered politically charged topics. So how do I avoid, you know, being political in my classroom, because I know that's not my place, but also still fight for justice for my students and not allow for hateful rhetoric?
Yeah. So two quick things. One, I'm a historian, so I always go to history to do the political work. That give students primary document. I don't know what your subject is.
Are English.
English, right. So you have primary texts, mm-hmm. right? Novels and mm-hmm. poetry and these kinds of things. I go back, I give them an archive. I give all my students an archive, like different texts that represent different positions and peoples and perspectives, and then have them tell me what strikes you and what sticks with you and what stories can we tell, what stories can't we tell, because this is an incomplete archive, and let go back to the root of it, right? Being radical means going to the root of things, mm-hmm. right? That's the definition I use of radical, rather than it's kind of left-wing extremist kind of thing as it gets caricatured. But going to the root of things, and going to the root of things for me as a historian is going to the root of history and those documents. So that's the first thing. I think that allows you a little bit of an out if you're anxious about politics in the mm-hmm. classroom. The second thing is I'm not anxious about politics in the classroom. And obviously teaching in a high school and teaching in a college is different. But I've done a lot of high school teaching too, and I've done a lot of work with middle schools. I'm coming to your school tomorrow, which I'm really looking forward
to. We're excited. I
think if to perform neutrality and to pretend you have no politics is a politics of its own. Mm-hmm. And that has gotten us into a lot of trouble, right? And so what I would say is own who you are. Be able to articulate your value system. And don't use teaching to indoctrinate and to create little versions of yourself. Mm-hmm. Right? I would never do that. All of my students know my politics. Every single one of them who has ever been in my classroom, you've seen me teach. I make no bones about that. Because we live in an age of Google, right? Mm-hmm. Like, they could, like, in class figure that out while I'm being objective, right? They could be following me on Twitter what I said about Trump 5 minutes before I got into class. And so I think, like, the goal of teaching is to open up, right, not to impose. Mm-hmm. And so you can have politics and not require your students to have that or shut down conversations simply because you don't agree with them, right? I think it's about opening that up. And I think part of opening that up is being honest and transparent about the values that drive your work.
Dr. Jefferson, go ahead.
I think what you said is exactly right. And I think that the idea of neutrality is such a, as you said, such a politically loaded term. And the way that it was destroyed for me was a professor of mine in graduate school actually told me, it's okay to have your politics in your work as long as you have the evidence. Right? So for me, as an instructor, the problem is not that we have a politics, it's that some folks have a politics and they don't have the evidence. Right? And that's why going back... That's why going back to the documents, yeah. right, is such a useful pedagogical tool. The other thing I would say is this, and I'm always, you know, I come from three generations of people who worked in high school as a high school instructors, and I'm always, you know, I've made the mistake before of putting my foot in my mouth and telling me imagining what it's like to be in a high school classroom when I'm not there. So you should take everything we're saying. Yeah, you're the teacher. Totally. You're the expert. Totally. You should take everything we're saying with a grain of salt, because ultimately, you are going to be the ones who figure out how to negotiate those spaces better than we are. Because we're really working with different materials and different expectations coming from a university space, coming from the community of writers about how politics is supposed to appear in our work. That's something that you are going to figure out and have to educate us so that we don't say something that doesn't actually apply to the lived experience of high school educators, elementary school educators, and school counselors. So I just want us to be cautious about that as well.
All right. Thank you. Next question, please.
I'm a student at Booker High School in the Law Academy, and I have a few questions that my peers wrote down, and I'm gonna ask them on behalf of them. What would you say if you do not know how to refer to a person as in like their gender pronouns?
Dr. McCarthy?
So the first thing I would say is don't assume that you know if you don't know. That oftentimes you don't know, and so you say what you think you know, and that's wrong. So I would say first don't make those kinds of assumptions, particularly in a world where gender is increasingly diverse and fluid. And what might be the case one day or one year might not be the case the next day or the next year, particularly with younger folks who are experimenting and experiencing identity in all sorts of ways. That's the first thing. The second thing is you can always ask people, how would you like to be referred to, right? Or listen carefully to the cues that they may be giving off, right? Because oftentimes people are saying things to you that they want you to hear, but they're not saying it directly. So listen more carefully, ask questions, and don't make assumptions.
Okay.
The next one is, what happens to this conversation when it seems like a gotcha moment for people to refuse to acknowledge racism and homophobia exist?
That's my question. It was actually started with Jussie Smollett. Okay. Oh. So it's a perfect storm, seems like a gotcha moment for people who refuse to acknowledge that racism, homophobia, hate crimes exist. So what happens to this conversation now? Yeah. If it's found that he, and it looks like he did make it up.
I mean,
Dr. Jeffries, go ahead.
I can't predict what will happen to the conversation. The reality is that the story he told was believable because there's so much historical precedent for it. It was when I first heard it reported, that's what I thought of. I thought about its place within a legacy of terrorism directed toward Black people, LGBTQ people, and Black LGBTQ people in particular. And this moment in time is especially dangerous one for folks in that type of jeopardy. So if you're asking what will the media do now and how will people who are opponents of human dignity weaponize this story for their own means, they will weaponize it the same way they weaponize all types of stuff, the same way they weaponize the drug war, the same way they weaponize the 9/11 attacks, right? That's not going to change. So my response and my sort of orientation toward the crisis that was identified through unfortunate means is the same as it always been, right? It's a real crisis whether this attack was staged or not. So I don't think we can worry about reacting to what those folks are going to do. They're going to do their thing anyway.
Right.
No.
The other thing too about the Jussie Smollett, it's still breaking news, right? I mean, I was hoping we wouldn't get a question about this, but I was scrolling through
Twitter.
That's
the fourth bet I lost.
Yeah. But I was doing this there anyway. And this is such a complicated story because it's still ongoing, it's still breaking, it's still unfolding. There are many narratives at play right now. There's the Chicago Police Department's narrative, which is, and they have a long history of narratives. There's Jussie Smollett's narrative. There's the two Nigerian friends' narrative. There's the media. I mean, there's all these competing narratives, and we don't yet know everything. So I don't want to make a statement about like whether or not he's telling the truth or he lied. But to Michael's point, I think the idea this was so believable because it's so true in the broader sense. And so I think for those of us, if this turns out to have been manufactured for whatever reason, if that happens, I think what we have to do as a response to this moment, which is a troubling moment and particularly treacherous moment, particularly for folks at the intersections of Black and queer communities, point to all of the evidence that happens on a weekly or daily basis of people who are queer people of color who are assaulted, who are victims of racism and homophobia and transphobia and the intersection of those kinds of prejudices. There's more than enough data, more than enough anecdotes, more than enough real stories to counter this. And I also think there's one other point I want to make is that people who are already, as I said, on the downside of discrimination are so susceptible in these moments to having one thing become everything, right? So every queer Black man, right, is now lying when they are telling their own truth about racism and about homophobia and violence and these kinds of things. And that's true, right? Why does this guy Hassan, who has stockpiles of guns, who has a Coast Guard clearance, who was arrested the other day with literally a hit list of professors and MSNBC anchors and politicians and Google searches for where do Congress people hang out the most in DC, right? Why isn't he a representation of all white people from the Coast Guard who own guns? But the Jesse Smollett now becomes the representation of all queer people of color. And so that we gotta resist that easy yoking together an elision of those stories.
What I'd like to do is get the last person in line will be the last question, so I'm going to ask you to come forward with your question. The last person in line will be the last, so you'll be the last one. But go ahead with your question.
I'm a student from Booker High School, and I'd like to know your opinions on how women aren't... I had this all in my head. How women aren't mentioned in the Constitution and how most of our rights are deemed are based on how the states deem us important.
I'm going to turn it back to you since you are our constitutional scholar, Dr. McCarthy.
Well, I mean, the Constitution wasn't by women or for women, right? I mean, Abigail Adams wrote letters to John Adams the whole time he was in the Revolution and crafting the laws and so forth. She said, remember the ladies, remember the ladies. You know, men would be tyrants if given the opportunity. Well, right? And the fact of the matter is when Thomas Jefferson said all men are created equal, which gets reappropriated by women over time and by other groups who were originally written out of the Constitution and those early rights and citizenship claims, they embrace that phrase, all men are created equal, and the things that were put into the Constitution to argue for their own, to protest the system, and then to argue for their own empowerment and rights and equality and so forth. And that's been a powerful engine. Those words still matter, even though in the context within which those words emerged, women were not taken into consideration as full and equal citizens or political participants or worthy of anything outside of the home, right? And then when you layer on top of that, you know, African-American women, right, or other kinds of, you know, working class or non-property owning women, and all sorts of native women, right? These were folks who were not in the political imagination of the people that crafted the laws. That doesn't mean the laws then can't be reappropriated and reinterpreted for claims of equity and equality, but the imagination of the founding fathers was very, very male, and it was very white, and it was very propertied, and it was very elite, and it was very other things. It doesn't make those documents irrelevant. It just makes them complicated.
All right, thank you. Next question, please.
Thank you for really going candidly. And I want to ask, as a public historian myself, is a question for both of the folks that work in the universities. How do you, I know you teach courses on protest and whatnot, but how do you encourage and how do you give the resources for students to be able to go into the fields that they're looking at and be able to survive in those jobs where we're looking at that is not forgiving or accepting? We talk about discrimination, but how do you really give them the tools to really be able to debate, to defend, to encourage? So I just want to ask about that.
Yeah, are you asking about students who go into jobs where that sort of political discourse isn't an accepted part of the workplace?
Right.
And
because they're in a university setting, they're nurtured.
Right.
But when they go out those doors, what do they do? And just want to ask you, how do you really prepare your students for that world out there? Because not a lot of people are going to be forgiving or accepting.
Right. I mean, I think at some level they know this. I mean, I don't want to paint all students as completely naive. I mean, I think they know that college is a temporary thing and that the kind of environment they're going to have in the classroom is not the kind of environment that they have when they're working. I mean, and this is the other thing that's worth pointing out. So many college students are already working. So this fake distinction, right, between a college student and someone who's part of the workforce, that's a very sort of elitist and imaginary idea of what a college student is. So many students are working full-time and going to school, right? So they know more about it than we do. I think what, you know, I don't have a great answer for you. What are we doing to teach them? I think that what I've seen, though, is that students are finding ways to cultivate and maintain their connections to spaces where that kind of talk and discourse remains alive in their lives, even when they go to the workplace. So whether it's something as loosely formed as social media or something more formal like a book club or just keeping in touch with friends and family with whom they can have those conversations, that's still happening. And secondly, this actually is related to the question about women's place in contemporary politics. I think we've seen a reinvigoration of political participation among young people in this country that's really, it's like the flame that we're all desperately trying to keep alive right now. I mean, we have seen, the Parkland students is the example that people point to in the March for Our Lives, which is an incredibly successful and I would add politically savvy campaign. Black Lives Matter was made up of a coalition of young political leaders, many of whom were quite young and continue to be active in the movement even if they don't have the fame of some of the Parkland students. The people who are participating in the Women's March, how many children did we see in the Women's March? It was the single largest day of organized protest in this country's history, 3.2 million people in the streets. So these lives, these political lives and the spirit of participatory democracy is already being lived. I mean, the classroom is not the place, in my opinion, where that's being cultivated in its, with its strongest potency. It's already being lived outside the classroom. So I think they're doing okay.
All right. All right, next question, please.
Hi, I'm also with Booker High School. A few things. So first, we all talked about today our basic rights, right? And something that Dr. Jeffries touched on are basic humanities. And would you all agree that all these basic humanities culminate to achieve equality, or at least that's what we're striving for?
Dr. Hubbard?
I don't know if I didn't fully understand that.
What was the...
So as a community, are we all striving to achieve equality amongst all people?
I would hope so. I would hope so. Yeah, I don't know if everybody actually is doing that, but yeah, that's a laudable.
So that's the ideal.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. And then, are there bad apples in every group?
I think we can answer that question rather quickly.
Yes. Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. Exactly.
All right.
This is like the rapid fire round.
All right. This is the lightning round. We're in the lightning round.
We all talked about a lot with power, and I'd like to say that power can very easily be shifted, as we saw with the Trump election, Trump being elected, and then like what you talked about, where immediately a more overt sense of intolerant speech was accepted. Mm-hmm. Right. So would you also agree that power has a very delicate balance that can very easily be shifted?
Is there a question?
Yes, there is a question. That's the last thing before the question.
I think the answer is yes.
I would say yes, but not easily shifted. I don't think it's easily shifted. I think shifting power is a very hard thing. But I would say yes, it can be shifted.
Okay.
It requires work.
So lastly, with all this established, how do we not only set things equal, but after that, keep them equal?
All right.
I can't wait to go to Booker High School tomorrow. Y'all are ready. I'm going to be up all night, like, prepping
for
this.
You got to prepare. You got to read the Constitution again.
I think this is a brilliant question, and it's one that people have sort of puzzled over, right? Philosophers have puzzled over this question, the relationship between like equal dignity and freedom, right? What are we going to do about balancing equality and freedom, right? Because if you truly want freedom and respect each individual's life to live as they want to, then inevitably people are going to be living different lives, and if lives are different, then they cannot by definition be exactly equal. But I think what we're really talking about when we talk about equality is formal legal equality and basic human rights as a starting point, right? And we can debate what's a basic human, or is healthcare a right, right? Is shelter a right? We can debate what that actually means. But formal legal equality, I think, is the place that we're all standing on to begin with. Equality of outcomes, right? If someone violates the law or harms someone else otherwise, right, and causes a sort of man-made or person-made sort of inequality, right? What are the consequences of that act, right? For in terms of lasting equality, that's a much more complicated conversation. But I think it's always good to limit, when we say equality, to be talking about formal legal equality and basic human rights rather than equality of outcomes. That's the road I would try to walk down.
I would just say, in addition to that, the idea, I mean, when Jefferson wrote All Men Are Created Equal, I like the idea of created equal, that people are created equal, whether it's by a creator or a god, some higher power, or by nature. They enter into the world as equal people, as human beings that are deserving of that kind of equal dignity and respect. And it's the systems of power and privilege that actually renders them unequal in the realities of the world that we live in. And so I think actually the idea of understanding all of us as equal in the eyes of a higher power or of nature, right, deserving of equal dignity and respect, is a way to actually use equality to critique the inequities of our society that we've made, that are man-made and woman-made and human-made, that we've created and perpetuated over time. And then to think about equality or equity as a kind of aspiration, that's something that is worthy of working towards and working hard towards. And when the pendulum of power shifts in one direction away from that project, further away from achieving that aspiration someday, then we have to do the work of wrestling the pendulum of history back and bending that long arc that Martin Luther King and others talked about in the direction of justice.
All right, thanks. Think of some questions for tomorrow, please. All right, thanks. Next question.
I'm terrified to go after the Booker T students. Mike, I asked this to you earlier. I'm fascinated by the idea of virtue signaling. And if you could speak to that, because in my mind, or maybe explain it, it seems like an inverse of dog whistling. It's overt about how wonderful I am, but maybe actually I'm not so wonderful underneath.
You know, we had briefly a conversation about virtue signaling on social media.
Could you repeat that? Virtue signaling?
Virtue signaling, right, where you're constantly posting things. It's like demonstrating how woke you are on social media, right? That's what, right? You're constantly sort of posting these things to indicate, mostly to your peers who already believe in you to begin with, that you are in fact the sort of good person you and they imagine yourself to be, right? It's a kind of there's a feedback loop where you're kind of reinforcing your idea of yourself, and it gets validated by the people who supposedly know you best, right? And you're sort of doing all of this in the name of social justice, right? It's a kind of flimsy, performative gesture towards social justice. And I think, you know, one of the things I didn't say is, you know, I'm not really that sure that the virtue signaling in and of itself is the crisis. I mean, we're all going to try to impress our friends, aren't we? that's sort of what we do, whether no matter we're talking about politics or something else. I think that perhaps the biggest danger of this is that when it comes to stand in for other forms of politics, that's where we run into a huge question, right? So if you're constantly tweeting the Black Lives Matter hashtag, but have never actually laid down in the street for Black Lives Matter, then what are you actually doing? Right, when it comes to replace other forms of politics, that's, and so then the question becomes, right, what's the relationship between, in particular, social media politics and lived politics? And there are some examples and some groups who attend to this this disconnect really quite well and say, we may start with a hashtag, but we're going to encourage you and instruct you how to participate in other ways, whether it's voter registration, whether it's civil disobedience, whether it's community education and community service. Some groups are doing that quite well, linking the social media virtue signaling world to other kinds of politics. Other groups are not, right, and are sticking to social media, sticking to the virtue signaling and the kind of gestures towards social justice at no actual cost, with no sacrifice and no real investment.
Okay. All right. Thanks.
You are both. Was that virtue signaling by coming up with those terms? Because they both began
that way. Well, So I would, this is a great question what lady asked was, the question was something like, what was the relationship between the hashtag Black Lives Matter and then the social movement Black Lives Matter? Didn't they begin?
It began as a hashtag.
Right.
And
so
did Me Too.
Right. But Burke, the activist who'd done the Me Too work, had been working on precisely this issue,
right.
Violent assault against, specifically against women and women of color, long before it became a hashtag. Mm-hmm. So the sequence there was not the same as Black Lives Matter. Black Lives Matter, it's true that the hashtag Black Lives Matter came before there was a movement that was known as Black Lives Matter. But Tometi, Colors, and Garza, who are the three black women who began the movement, were already working as community activists, so they had a politics in place too. So it's true that sequentially, the hashtag for Black Lives Matter started before the movement for Black Lives Matter, but the work predated the hashtag.
Right. I just meant in terms of that as being like a impetus for a lot of action on the part of other people.
Oh, no question. Yeah. Yes, yes.
Okay. All right, next question. All right,
thank you. My question comes from my just personal experience and observations over my 47 years on this planet, and that my interaction with people of color, LGBTQ, in a personal and small social group setting has always been a very positive experience, and that I've gotten to appreciate and respect the people and the value they're bringing to whatever interaction we're having. And so move forward 20, 30 years, social media comes out, and now I see people creating these positive feedback loops on very negative comments and very negative language, and then isolating themselves so that they can just be in that group and get affirmation in that group. So I'm wondering kind of what your thoughts are, the interplay of that social media with what we saw here on stage tonight, which is a group of kids of all different ethnicities doing something together, and how that is playing. Is that having an impact on the world today?
Dr. McCarthy?
Yeah, absolutely. It's having an impact on the world. So the virtual space is shaping the real space in ways that we've never seen before from a cultural standpoint and a political standpoint, I think. And so we have to be mindful of that. Yet we're in the midst of it, and so many of us are caught up in it and are concerned about it, but participate in it. We're both perpetrators and critics, right? And we're both producers and consumers. And we have this like weird way in which these roles that are often discrete in other realms are actually yoked together on social media. Like, I don't know one person and I'm pretty active on social media, and I don't know one person in my peer group that I'm sort of actually friends with who's also as active on social media as I am, who has not both participated in that echo chamber feedback loop thing that you were just talking about something, and done some negative stuff on social media this week, and privately messaged each other, tweeted to each other, had conversations with each other about how we need to get off social media, right? Like we've done both of those things, right? I mean, I am always like, I mean, I post about how exasperated I am with Twitter before I tweet, right? And it's like, and it makes no sense. And I do worry about that it is like creating in us a kind of like a combustible contradiction, right? That is ultimately going to have its way in the world. And I don't know how any way around it other than to develop your practices about this. Actually, there were a group of us that were concerned, we were at an actual dinner party, and a group of us were talking about how we were exhausted with social media and how we felt like we were becoming more nasty. That was the conversation. And we're all sort of public intellectuals, and we do this work, and some are in politics, some are in the academy, some are in nonprofit work, human rights advocacy, and so forth. And we're a very diverse group of people, and all of us were like, we had a shared concern about ourselves in this realm. And so what we have decided to do is we kind of like have this pact. Whenever we're like going into that place again, we like text each other. We're like, don't go there, right? And we kind of not police each other, but we hold each other to account in ways, because we don't want to become nasty folks. We want to be productive, right? In our own ways of thinking about that. So I don't know if there's an answer beyond that, because this ain't going away either. Right, this is not going away. We can bury our head in the sand about social media and its impact on culture and language and politics and everything else, but it's proliferating, certainly at this point in history, and I don't see that decelerating anytime soon.
Okay. All right.
And one more question quick. I grew up just south of San Francisco. I was born and raised there. Now I've lived in Sarasota for the last 10 years. The difference in the language and the communication, the social interaction between races and LGBT was just mind-blowing to me, right?
Here or there?
Here. So I'm wondering, from your political backgrounds, your teaching backgrounds, why is there such a massive dichotomy between the West and the East Coast, North and South? What, like, how does this exist in a free world?
Bay Area, in my experience, is very different from other parts of, like, Bakersfield. I think it's probably really different from Bakersfield, for example.
That's true. California yeah. is a big state.
Yeah. So I don't know. My experience of that was that it's, like, it's a very particular environment in terms of being intolerant of certain ideas, which I think it's, I actually think that's kind of good. I used to say I thought it was like boot camp, like everybody should have to like have their like beliefs questioned like constantly for like a year at least, and then they can go back out into the other world. Because that was my experience at Berkeley. It was just constantly being told like, no, you don't understand this, you don't, it's very challenging. And I think it's good, and I think that actually doesn't happen in a lot of places. And I don't think it's true of all of California. I mean, I'm assuming I know what you're talking about also, by the way. So
I think you do.
All right, thank you. And then we have our last question. I have a few acknowledgments, and then I'll be ending the program. So yes, your question.
Hi, good evening. My name's Iyanu. I'm a new college student, and I also helped put together the Black History Month program for the last few years.
Hey, professor.
And my question is that, well, I usually get frustrated because I find myself at these events and with other people at these events, and we've been talking about ideological walls and feedback loops, and it's usually, like, people who already agree, like, come to the event and go, that sounds cool, like, right now. And so I'm just, like, asking, you know, have any of you been to an event where, like, people who don't already agree have attended, or have you organized such an event? One, how did it go? Two, how did you get them there? Three, do you also get frustrated at these events when it's a bunch of people who feel the same way?
That's a confrontation, though, isn't it? I mean, it's like a lot of times that literally is, it's not like an event or coming together so much as a confrontation. So, for example, I live in New Orleans, and people intentionally left New Orleans and went to Metairie, which is a suburb, which is where David Duke is from. They basically said, okay, we're going to say and have the same rally we'd have in New Orleans over here. But I don't know that it was literally a confrontation. But that was in part what people were responding to, is that we're always talking to each other, and what happens if you try to say that in a different context. So I don't know, maybe you were talking about being trained for political, to engage others, right? In a purposeful manner.
Yeah, and I'll be brief. I mean, this is such an important question for colleges and universities and elsewhere. I mean, the thing that I'll say about it is, for social psychologists and other folks who work on prejudice reduction, right, or changing someone's mind about something, the way to change someone's mind is not to like come at them with facts and have a kind of confrontational. Mm-hmm. So if the goal of the event is that, it's almost always going to be doomed. I hate to be the bearer of bad news, right? The goal of the event is I'm going to get together with people who don't agree with me, and by the end, they're going to agree with me. You're probably going to be disappointed. There are, however, right, all kinds of studies that show that if what you're interested in is prejudice reduction and opening up dialogue, you should, and this is what the research has, not my opinion, you should focus on building sort of cooperation and trust around things that are not necessarily right at the heart of your disagreement. So, for example, if you have a club or a student organization of people that you know is ideologically different from you, and you would like to somehow bridge the gap so that you're not at each other's throats in class or giving each other nasty looks when you walk by each other on campus, doing things like a community cleanup or some other sort of something off campus outside the general rules of interaction where you can build cooperation and trust and you start to see each other as individuals rather than group members, that is the key to prejudice reduction. Now, is prejudice reduction alone enough to end racism? No, it is not. But if you want to have genuine dialogue with someone, you've got to be able to start there, cooperation and trust building, not necessarily arguments with evidence. That's the very modest advice that I would give.
And Dr. McCarthy, go ahead.
Just to add to that, I mean, I spend a lot of my time in my work now with graduate students training organizers and activists and advocates in social justice and human rights spaces and in political and policy advocacy. And I often tell them that, and I do some of this training that you were mentioning before. I mean, some of the skills building stuff that happens in class is to be ready for those moments when you're the only one, right? When you're up against a mountain of opposition, or you find yourself in a room with a lot of people who are adversaries or enemies, not the choir, and to be able to build those strategies and do that. And part of that comes from my own background as someone who's also been an activist and a social justice organizer and so forth in so many of those spaces. I mean, there was a generation where I was often the only queer person in a space where people were yelling at me about the rights I was trying to organize for, right? And to be able to handle yourself in that space is really, really important. And to be able to have the skills to do that, where you're not just shouting at each other, but you're figuring out a way to win that battle, because these are culture wars, right, sometimes. And so I think the other side of that is that sometimes you need spaces where people who are of like mind come together. I just spent a weekend last weekend in Provincetown in Cape Cod, which is like I call it the little slice of heaven at the end of America, right? It's like and it's the only place in the world where I feel comfortable holding my husband's hand in public. The only place in the world. And like, if I don't have that to retreat to when I'm in spaces where I'm fighting the fights, right, I wouldn't be able to endure, right? So I think we need both of these spaces. We need both the spaces where the choir comes together, right, and we kind of affirm each other, and we understand each other, and we sort of gird each other. And then I also think we need to be ready for those spaces where we have to have those difficult conversations. We have to be in the battles that ultimately further the kind of equity and justice and dignity and respect that we've been talking about. So I think both are necessary. But I share your concern, and I also understand what it's like to be one of the only ones in a room where everyone's coming at you.
All right, thank you. Before we end tonight, I want to acknowledge a few things. First of all, Dr. Jeffries and Dr. McCarthy have engaged not only you tonight, but they will be engaging students at New College. Obviously, students at Booker will have the opportunity to quiz Dr. McCarthy again. And so we appreciate that outreach. Appreciate Dr. Hubbard coming down from my favorite city, New Orleans. Those of you who attended the program last year when we had the Freedom Riders, Dr. Jeffries was a participant, obviously, but in the audience, one of the original Freedom Riders is present, and that's Ellen Ziskin. Ellen, if you want to stand. Ellen, Ellen has, as she did last year, I mean, she is living history, and she has engage Booker High School so that they will have an understanding of what the history is of the civil rights movement. So, Ellen, we appreciate that. I want to thank Litton and Dan Boxer and the Boxer Diversity Initiative. I want to thank my favorite college president, Donald O'Shea. And I want to thank New College, the staff and faculty, and everyone who put this on, Manatee Educational Television for filming this. I want to thank Dr. McCarthy, Dr. Hubbard, and Dr. Jeffries for being here. And thank you all for coming. Have a pleasant evening. Good night.